Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Almost every day, we see maps. If we watch the weather forecast, we see maps. If we're trying to find a place, we use maps. If we're learning about a country or state, we use maps. In this video, we'll introduce 6 common map types, which are world, country, regional, state, city, and weather. Then we'll introduce how to use a paper map and compass to find somewhere, what map distortions are, and technology applications of maps. We'll start by introducing world maps. A world map shows us where major land masses and bodies of water are in the world. Many of these are made from actual photos taken from planes, so we'll have colors of what the land looks like from high up in the air. Green usually means plants, like trees or grass. Brown can mean sand, like in a desert. Light blue means shallow water, and dark blue is deep water. The water may be rivers, lakes, or oceans. For a place to be white on a map, that generally means it has ice all year, like the Arctic, Antarctica, or places near those poles. We use the term natural geographical features to refer to things made by nature, like mountains, fields of grass, bodies of water, and coastlines. There is often the choice to view a world map without or with borders. A border is an imaginary line that countries use to show where the edge of their countries are. They can be based on a natural feature, or they can be somewhere that has nothing unusual. For example, much of the southern border of the continental U.S. is defined by a river called the Rio Grande that runs between Texas and Mexico. The Rio Grande is a natural geographical feature. In contrast, much of the American border with Canada runs along land that has no unusual features. Next, we'll introduce country maps. If we zoom in, then, instead of a world map, we'll see just one country. We can see the natural geographical features of the land, such as bodies of water, mountains, and deserts. Sometimes, no other country is shown on a country map, but other times country maps, like this one, will show neighboring countries, such as Canada and Mexico. Borders between countries are shown as a solid line. In contrast, dashed lines are used to show divisions within a country, such as states or provinces. Sometimes individual cities are labeled on a country map, especially the country's capital city. Next, we'll introduce regional maps. A regional map can mean several different things. It can mean several countries in one area, or it can mean a portion of one country. For example, the Middle East is a region in this part of the world. But if we're using the term regional map for one country, then we're talking about just a portion of the country. For example, in the U.S., the major regions are the West, Midwest, South, and Northeast. Sometimes we divide these regions into even smaller regions. For example, the Northeast region can be further divided into the Mid-Atlantic and the New England regions. A regional map is often used for tournaments that only include states in that part of the country. Regional maps are often used as the basis for weather maps, since many weather events are quite big and span several states. Regional maps are also used by huge companies with offices in many states so that they can have regional directors who make frequent visits to just a few states. The names of specific regions and which states are in a region can vary depending on who's defining a region and for what purpose. We can see natural geographical features in better detail as we zoom into a regional map further. But we also notice more structures made by people, such as roads. These human-made structures are easier to see if we switch to the road view. The shield-shaped symbols that are colored red, white, and blue, with the word interstate written on top, show where major roads called interstate freeways are located. The prefix inter means between, so the word interstate means roads that go between states. Interstate freeways have no traffic lights or stop signs because they're designed to let people travel between states and major cities as quickly as possible. Next, we'll introduce state maps. If we zoom in further, then we can see just one state. In addition to showing better details of the natural geographical features, state maps will show many more cities and roads than regional maps. State maps are helpful when planning a long trip that may go between cities that are far apart or connected by major roads. They're also useful when learning about the state that you live in or are interested in visiting. Next, we'll introduce city maps. If we zoom in closer, then we get to a city-level map. We still have the option to see the natural features of the land, but at this level, we can zoom in so close that we can even see buildings, whether photographs of them or drawings. Most of the time, people use city maps, so they can see the names of small roads that they will then use to drive to a place. Sometimes, we call city maps by another name, which is street maps. Next, we'll introduce weather maps. A weather map is useful for knowing what weather to expect in the next few days. You may see these during a news forecast or on special websites. Here's an example from the National Weather Service. By choosing what we're interested in, we can then see information that is laid on top of a map, like a country map. We have the option to zoom in, so we can see the information laid on top of several states. So, this would be a regional weather map. Or, we can zoom in closer and just look at one state. Weather maps rarely focus on just one city since weather systems are so big that it's helpful to see more area than just a city. Weather maps are not intended to help people find how to get to a particular place, so they don't show the names of small roads. But they may include the names of cities and major roads like freeways and highways, so people can recognize where they live on the map and get an idea of what weather is coming their way. We'll discuss weather maps more in the video series on weather. Next, let's learn how to find a place using a paper map and compass. As a reminder, you should never go somewhere new until you're an adult, or are with an adult who your parents or guardian have said it's okay to be with. Let's say your family is renting an apartment for a week to have a vacation in a place you've never visited. Your family is standing near the pool and wants to walk to the dock by the pond. Is this the correct way to hold the map? The key for knowing how to hold the map is that the arrow pointing north on the map must point in the same direction as the needle pointing north on your compass. We have to turn the map so that the map's arrow is pointing in the same direction as the arrow on the compass. Plus, the map and compass should be in a horizontal position. As we walk, we need to hold the map so that its arrow is aligned with the north on the compass. That means that when there is a bend in the road and our direction changes, then we need to adjust how we hold the map so that the map's arrow is always pointing towards the north, as shown by the needle on the compass. Even if there are no street signs like in this complex of buildings or at camping grounds, we can still find our way if the map is accurate and we have a reliable compass. Many maps only show where north is. Although we generally remember that south is on the opposite side of north, it can be hard to remember which sides west and east are on. One way to remember this is that if you put their letters together, they should spell the word we. The word we means together. It's more fun to use a compass and to do other camp activities when people are together rather than alone. Next, we'll introduce what map distortion is. Do you think that Greenland and Africa are about the same size? If we could bring Greenland down to the equator, we would see that Africa is more than 14 times bigger than Greenland. Land that is near the North and South Poles will appear much bigger on some types of rectangular maps than they are in real life. Although the shape of the land is correct, the land size is wrong. We call this error map distortion. In the video on latitude and longitude, we'll explain why some rectangular world maps distort the sizes of land masses. The problem that mapmakers have struggled with for hundreds of years is how to represent the Earth, which is shaped like a globe, on maps which are flat. There is no easy solution, so we just have to know that compared with globes, maps are not as good when we're looking at the entire world. But the good news is that small-scale maps, such as those that are of one country or an even smaller area, are generally fairly accurate. Next, let's look at technology applications for maps. Although we frequently learn about maps using paper, nowadays few people use paper maps. Instead, many people prefer to use their smartphones or a dedicated device with GPS or an internet site. One reason is because paper maps can go out of date quickly, especially if we live in an area with new road construction. Other reasons many people prefer maps on a device with GPS is because their location is updated on the map. In this case, the blue arrow is moving around the map as the car moves. Plus, we don't have to worry about turning the map to keep it orientated with the North Pole, since the GPS system takes care of that. And many of these devices will speed the directions, which lets the driver focus on the road. Here's a summary of this video and some additional information. Please pause the video if you wish to read this. Thanks for your attention.